Welcome, everybody. What an exciting juncture for us that we are finally here to partake the prasad from chapter one and then move on to chapter two. So it's a very exciting time, and we are really only ten verses away from the teachings of Lord. So it's something. Imagine how many lifetimes it must have taken to come to this juncture. I'm emotional because I'm not a professional Gita teacher. There are people in India, that's what they do for a profession, like for a livelihood, for a vocation. They every 2-3 years they teach Gita, then they start again, then they start again. So imagine what a blessed life they have. I'm a teacher of many things, many three sciences. And so I find it as a deep privilege to be able to not only receive Gita, I've received it several times, but to actually partake it. And this will be the one time that I teach the Gita. So I personally feel as privileged to be sitting at the feet of Lord Krishna, because He is the Jagat Guru. He is the Guru. And we are all really receivers of this Gnan. Ah, what a fascinating teaching. And let me spend an hour and a half judiciously. So I want to spend about 15 minutes reviewing chapter one. I want to spend 45 minutes talking to you about chapter one. No, I want to spend 15 minutes talking to you about chapter one, another 30 minutes talking to you, and the rest of the time I want to introduce you to chapter two. So, chapter one, for those of you who are been coming along and watching and listening to all the verses and the classes, it's we are now understanding that there is a presentation of a universal disease, and the universal disease is samsara. And in fact, the whole chapter one is a presentation of that samsara. But in short, from verse 1 to 20, we open into a magnificent battle scene, an ancient battle scene with elephants, horses, conches, spears, all kinds of things that we can imagine an ancient battle to be like, very tense. And that is what we come across in verse 1 to 20. And we also come across Arjuna's nemesis, Duryodhana, his evil cousin. And we also, it's not clear, but it's like subtle. And the teacher points out, look how he is talking to his teacher. Because later we have also another dialogue between, Arjuna and Lord Krishna. And though Arjuna was distressed, he went into a panic attack. He never really was disrespectful ever to Lord Krishna. There was this basic vinay, this basic manners, this basic remembrance that I'm talking to somebody noteworthy. Even before Lord Krishna became his guru, he was still a mentor, an advisor, an uncle, somebody respected in the community, and a teacher-like figure. Let's just say a teacher, not just a guru yet. Definitely a very important person, because between Lord Krishna's army and Lord Krishna himself, Arjuna had chosen for Krishna to be with him. So he got moral support from Krishna, and he never lost his demeanor towards Krishna himself. Whereas we come across Duryodhana lambasting Drona left and right and kind of trying to shift blame upon him, and also his his mannerisms are quite questionable. So in 1 to 20, we come across all of this. And then from 21 to 25, suddenly, and this is destiny, that Arjuna says, take me in the center of the battlefield, a little closer to that other side. Let me survey. And between 21 and 25, this happens. He says, let me survey the other side. In fact, in 23, he says, let me survey those durbuddhi, those people with those pretty corrupted consciousness who are supporting this durbuddhi, this disturbed-minded cousin of mine, Duryodhana. So he was quite justifiably angry. I mean, after all, it had been years and years of mishandling, abuse, disrespect, cheating, and all kinds of things that had, that the he and his brothers had been receiving at the hands of Duryodhana and his brothers. So he said, so take me. And between 21 and 25, and they talk, and then Krishna takes him there. And, in verse 25, he says, Pashyatam Samaveta Kuruniti. Because, now he was, his chariot, Krishna and the chariot that Lord Krishna was, navigating, in which Arjuna was the judgment, the important person who was going to be in the war. It was situated in such a central location that he could see the whole clan, because it was really one clan split up. And the clan was known as the Kuru clan. And, on one side were the Pandava brothers, on one side were the Kaurava brothers, who were really children of two blood brothers. So he says, Lord Krishna just says this one thing, look, you can see your entire clan. When he sees familiar faces, everything turns. And suddenly, instead of seeing people who have been evil, who've been adharmic, who've been unjust, who've been corrupt, who are molesters, who are murderers, who are, looters. Now he keeps using that one word, swajanam. He starts seeing my people, my people, my people. So there is a change. And from 26 to 28, we see the emergence of what is known as ragaha or attachment. The different ragaha is an attachment which is irrational, which is emotional in nature, not real, not rational. It's irrational. And we feel like our whole life depends upon something. So everybody can like tea or coffee, but ragaha would be when we develop an addiction to it. Even when we are told it's not good for it, we cheat and go and drink it on the side. So that's called ragaha. So the Vedas are not against us enjoying tea, coffee, or relationships. What they want to alert us to is ragaha, where sometimes some judicious distance between a loved one and a cup of coffee may be exactly what you need for your health and the planet's health. But ragaha will not allow us to come out of, to even think of a new solution, because we are so warped in our attachment to things being what they are. So we see amply in between 26 and 28, especially verse 28 is important. Mark that one, where he starts lamenting, oh, I see my uncles and my maternal uncles and my in-laws and my ex. And he keeps repeating himself also. Swajanam, swajanam, my people, my people. So from ragaha, in the disease of samsaraha, emotional turbulence, after ragaha or attachment, typically what follows is shokaha or grief. And so between about 26 to 28 is ragaha, and somewhere in between the ragaha starts turning into shokaha or grief. So we see between 25 and 34 lots of lamenting, grief, sorrow. And then from 35 to 47, we see full-blown delusion, moha. And moha is shown by where everything gets reversed. He starts feeling like he's the criminal because he has come here to avenge justice. He forgets that he's come here to actually stand up for what's right, what's truth. And he starts saying, look at me, I've come here for a minor kingdom. Look at me, and I'm going to kill my own people. What for a kingdom? And finally, he concludes in verse 47 with this, I would just stand there without any weapons, and I would rather be killed by them. So I would not even want to pick up a weapon. I would just rather be killed by this army. And that's the right thing to do. That's the dharmic thing to do. So the whole thing, after 14 years of diplomacy, multiple trials at peace, willingness to accommodate, over-accommodate, almost several times being murdered, almost murdered, and escaping from that murderous plots of Duryodhana, his wife almost being molested in public by Duryodhana and brothers, everything he put aside. And in that moment of attachment and grief, delusions took over and he could not think straight. And the number one cardinal symptom of Mohaha is we lose our way. We don't know what to do. And so it ends at a pitiable note. At 47, we see that the man who on verse 23 was saying, take me yonder, Krishna, where I can look at those evil faces who are supporting my evil-minded cousin Duryodhana, Durbuddhi. Let me go there and, you know, like, let me make a mark of who are all the people who need, you know, a good lesson today. There was this Arjuna the soldier, and we see at the end Arjuna the brother. That's what happens. The soldier gets reduced to a brother, and his pledge for much debated action reduces to non-action, and righteousness gets covered by escapism and let me leave, let me take sannyasa. He even quotes scriptures. After all, scriptures also say that is the better way to go, to stay away. So he's even quoting scriptures to the scripture giver. And so he's a pathetic case. And I pointed out in my classes how he kept repeating himself also. So this is a subtle theatrical insertion by the author Vyasacharya to show that when person is clear-minded, they don't repeat themselves. But Arjuna was repeating. He kept pointing out, look who's standing, look who's standing, look who's standing. So we see rajas, attachment, plus grief. And, you know, in the grief, we see, he says, you know, Sidanti Mamagatrani, my hands are shaking, the bow is slipping, my mouth is dry. It was a full-blown, panic attack. This is the symptoms of anxiety neurosis. That's what was happening to him. And he was even saying, I'd rather kill myself. So depression and suicidal tendencies, everything happened in that few moments, actually. So then this leads to moha, and I think it's a shut case. He says, I'm done. I'd rather be killed by him. So, you know, if somebody were to only read up to chapter one, they would think that Arjuna has given a lot of explanation why he should not be fighting this war. And at one level, they are all actually reasonable. So they are not unreasonable. So one would think that this is what happened. Arjuna left the war. And this is where we end. What I want to point out to you is that when we are about to receive knowledge, this chapter is very important to us because there is one is first caught in the samsara, caught in the disease. One doesn't even know one is caught in it. So all the way in chapter one, Arjuna doesn't know that he's suffering from his own created virtual hell. He doesn't know that. He thinks it's very real. So this is called experience of samsara. So chapter one is experience of samsara. But, you know, when we open chapter two, which is a chapter of 78 verses, what will happen is very interestingly that in verse 3 of chapter 2, he will get a scolding from Krishna. I've had many students who get a scolding and then they're then their journey begins. Some need multiple scoldings because they need it. But anyway, you get a scolding. We'll go over it later. Because of the scolding, by the time verse 7 comes along, he, instead of just being caught in his virtual world and his decision to leave, he questions. He says, I am confused. I can't decide whether I because he had decided by end of chapter 1. I'm leaving. I'm quitting. I have decided. Here are all, like a lawyer, he had quoted all the reasons he should leave. But clearly, he was enough of a soldier and he was enough of a wise person somewhere. And also due to the scolding he got briefly, this short one, he said, wait, oops. So should I go to war? So in chapter 2, things turn. And instead of being very convinced about his action, he realizes he is confused and he realizes he is confused. So this is called, one is called experience of the problem, dear students, and this is called discovery of the problem, that it's not them, it's me. I am confused. And then we will see that in chapter 2, he goes up to Lord Krishna and says, please help me. And then when he asks for help, so this is called asking for help. Once you've discovered you have the problem, you go to an expert for help. So this is called seeking help. And in the fourth stage, when you are ready for a guru, the guru appears and his friend transforms into a guru. His teacher or his guide transforms, his occasional guide, occasional help, transformed into guru, and the guru became God. So it's like these are four stages. Experience of the problem, when you're bound in it. This is what we all go through. We're like, we've had an argument with our somebody, some relative or friend, and we're really some employee, some peer, some colleague, and we're really reeling in it. And it could happen both ways. We're either blaming them, and in Arjuna's case, he was taking all the blame. It could happen either. It's like a virtual world. It's not thinking clearly. Then in the second stage, if grace is with you, in the second stage, you'll say, wait a minute, is this the only reality? I need help. When you say, I need help, then if you have an expert, then you go to that expert and say, please help me. And if the expert is willing to teach you, then you get help and the disease is resolved. So this is what happens, chapter 2 onwards. All right. So are you ready for some teachings from chapter 2? Okay. So like I said, that in chapter 2, it is known as Sankhya Yoga. But there are four topics in Sankhya Yoga. And the four topics that happen in Sankhya Yoga are the first one, of course, is Sankhya Yoga itself. Sankhya Yoga means, Sankhya means jnanam here, knowledge here, self-knowledge here. So it's right away. He starts with giving from 1 to 10. We see that Arjuna realizes that he has the problem of samsara, that he is confused. He doesn't know if he should have inaction or action. He doesn't know. And so he wants to paralyze, as Aparna said. He wants to be paralyzed. That was the word. But he saw through it somewhere by God's grace. Maybe this was meant to happen. So he goes up to Lord Krishna and says, please accept me as your student and please teach me. So then from verse 11 to 38, we will have the teachings of Samkhya Yoga, which is like the big picture. And, Lord Krishna gives various reasons for what kind of he should be action. Inaction is not an option. You have to take action. Inaction is not an option. You cannot hide. Cannot hide. And here is how you take the right action. Here is how you determine. But then what he does is he gives three types of drishti. In English, we call it three types of worldviews. In Sankhya Yoga, from verse 11 to 38, he gives the worldview of the biggest truth possible, that everybody is Atman. It's all Brahman. Nobody dies. So it's all eternal. It's a game. It's a dream. So do what the right thing to do. So he gave the very big picture. And so that is known as the Adhyatmaka, the spiritual perspective. That's what he gives. Then from 31 to 33, he gives the Dharmika perspective. You are a soldier, so it's your duty. Go and fight. You know, you are a teacher, teach. Aparna, you are the dean, be the dean. You know, Ishani, you are the editor of Hamsa, be the editor. So it's a duty based. This is what you got to do. You got to tell this. You got to be strong here. You got to be weak here. Not weak here, soft here, strong here, mild here, based on duty. What does your duty require? What does Aparna's duty require? What does Soham's duty require? What does Ishani's duty require? What does Shunya's? And they have to be accordingly like that. So that's called Dharmika. It's not personal. It's not personal. It's your duty requires that. Like right now when I teach you, I'm in my Acharya duty. My Acharya talks like this, teaches like this, corrects like this, course corrects like this, edits like this, pauses you like this, makes you look at things a certain way. That's your dharmic duty. You do it. So that's another perspective that he provides. Then a third perspective by which he persuades Arjuna to take the right action, which in this case, not every case, is to go to the battle and fight until death for victory, is called the Laukika perspective or the worldly perspective. This is why everyday people talk. But even that makes sense. Well, people will laugh at you. People will call you a coward. Come on, do it. Do the right thing. So he even said that. So there is the very big, expansive, ultimate truth, which is Sankhya Yoga. Then there is a medium truth, which is Dharma, Jnanam, self, Dharma. And then finally, world, Laukika. So he gives this third perspective. So from 34 to 36, he gives the worldly perspective. Then Arjuna thinks and he says, so there are really people who understand all these perspectives, and on top of that, they become stable in it. You know, because we are all hearing knowledge and it sounds wonderful when we hear it, but when the time comes to fight that battle, we don't remember it. Because why? Because that knowledge has not become stable in us, right? It has not become stitta, strong in us. So he says, are they really people who are stitta prajna? Prajna means knowledge. And stitta means stable. And what do they look like? What are their, you know, how do they appear? How do they talk? How do they move? How do they eat? What do they do? How do they control? How do they become stable in their wisdom with all this knowledge that you're giving, Krishna? So from, I missed in between. And then after he has taught the spiritual perspective, the dharmic perspective, and the worldly perspective, which is from 34 to 36, then from 37 to 39, Lord Krishna teaches Karma Yoga. So first there was Jnana Yoga, then Dharma, then worldly perspective, and then he even gives a short summary of Karma Yoga, which the whole chapter 3 will be about Karma Yoga, but he doesn't sweep it away. He kind of gives the full picture. And then after that, from 40 to 53 is Karma Yoga. Then from 54 till the end, he it talks about this sthita prajna. What are, so now Krishna is very curious. There are actually people who understand Gnana Yoga. They know what is their dharma. They understand how to live in the world. They understand they understand karma yoga. They are living both the world's lifestyles. Wow, who are those people? And this is where then we are introduced to the ideal of how we all want to be. And that person is called a sthita prajna. And from 54 onwards, we listen about an ideal person, an ideal spiritual person who's also a jnani, who's also a karma yogi. And, you know, and we also learn ways to be like that, how to control our mind and our senses. So as you can see, it's a very full chapter. It's full of knowledge. And in a way, all these themes will re-come back in other chapters in more details. So you could say that chapter 2, my dears, is like a, it's like a window into all of Bhagavad Gita. That's why chapter 2 is called the essence. And that is why chapter 2 is, if people can't study any other chapter for lack of time or lack of ability to study for any reason, then they will choose chapter 2 because they get summary of pretty much all the topics. Okay, so that is something that we are going towards. Now, let me chant to you. Let me share with you how in I want to share with you one verse from chapter 2, and then I'll share with you one verse from chapter 18, last chapter, and how they are connected because Arjuna becomes a Shishya. So let me say, remember I told you that in chapter 3, he got a slight scolding from Krishna, because of which he at least stopped, his samsara stopped, like, wait, whoa. And typically he, instead of feeling upset that he got scolded, he said, oh, wait, maybe there is another way, I should ask Krishna. So he says, he chants, Arjuna Vacha, Karpanya doshopahata swabhava Prichami tvam dharma sammuda chetaha Yachreyasthyan nishchitam bruhitan me Shishyasteham shadi mam tvam prapannam. Last line. Shishyasteham shadi mam tvam prapannam. So this is verse number 7 in chapter 2, and he says, Karpanya dosho pahata swabhava. He says, my mind is overpowered by a new kind of dosha. We know vata pitta kapha. He says there is another dosha called karpanya dosha. Karpanya means the dosha of helplessness. Have you all experienced it? Powerlessness, helplessness, confusion, misery, anxiety, and feeling stuck. So he says, my mind is overpowered by helplessness. Dharma sammuna chetaha. And my intellect, my buddhi, my ability to think is completely deluded regarding what is my action. What is dharma? What is a dharma? So this is Arjuna taking ownership. He's taking ownership. And he says, and my intellect, I am deluded. I am in moha. I am completely sammuraha. Muda, the word means stupid. I am feeling stupid. Sometimes I have students say, Shunyaji, I'm feeling stupid. Guide me. And that's student taking, you know, it's okay. Because who was saying it? Was it Soham saying it? It's not personal, right? It's happening. It's somebody... It's for everybody. So he says, dharma sammuda chetaha. Chetaha means your chaitanyam. I'm confused. Tvam prachami. So I ask you, bruhitat, tell me, yat syat, which is nishyatam shreyaha. Shreya means what is definitely spiritually good for me. Then please tell me, what is definitely good for me? So you give me the definite, nishchayatmak, definite response. That is what we tell our teacher. I have this option, I have that option. Tell me which is the definite option. Definitely good for me. And then he says, aham te shishyaha. Now, for the first time, they have had, there might be another 30,000 verses in Mahabharata where they have been talking, planning, strategizing, discussing, laughing, dealing with the situations in creative ways, because Arjuna, Krishna was like an advisor to these five brothers. But for the first time, he says, I am your disciple. Aham te shishyaha. Śādhi māṁ, teach. And Soham, if you can show them, he sits down below him. Because, you know, in culturally, it is not written it's not like written in the script that at that time Arjuna sat down. But whenever we say, Śādhi māṁ prapannam tvam, prapannam means surrender. I surrender my ego to you. So this is, you know, probably a painting where Krishna and Arjuna are friends. So they are at a similar level. And now look at the next image. Now he sat down and said, Aham te shishyaha śādhi māṁ prapannam tvam. Teach me who has surrendered to you. So when we say surrender, immediately in our culture, in the Vedic culture, if the teacher is standing, the student is sitting below. If the teacher is sitting, the student will not tower up. There will always be a certain protocol. So he sat down and said, I have surrendered to you. So, and Śādhi māṁ, Śādhi means, there are teachers who say, okay, I will just awaken you through my eyes, through my mantra, through my touch. And we are not doubting all that. But Śādhi māṁ, in our case, we don't believe that a mantra or a touch can remove our ignorance. We want to be educated. So Śādhi māṁ means, give me systematic jnanam, give me systematic knowledge. I am surrendering my time, my ego, my sensitivity, everything I am giving to you. I am with you. In fact, there is another word in this shloka which says, karpanya dosho pahata swabhava, upahata swabhava. Swabhava means how I'm feeling, my heart, my mind. Upahata means like my discrimination faculty has become clogged. It has become blocked. It has become stifled. It is full of emotions and ego and confusion and anger and past and present and future fear. It's become, and that is what is giving birth to this helplessness. But we all get to study from Lord Krishna, because Arjuna, in probably if in verse 3, Krishna scolds him, and he could have said, you don't understand. You're not my kind of teacher. I know what's going on. Many students do that. They can't take it. They don't want, sometimes when the student's samsara is not correct, then the teacher has to say, stop. Wake up. You know, it has to be a strong one to kind of bring the samsara, virtual throbbing of the samsara. At least for a minute, it has to stop. Only then knowledge can be given. So what happened was that this is the sign of a good shishya, that he actually, samsara stopped enough for him to ask for help. Jama. Stop. And he said, that please accept me as a teacher. Now it's interesting. Now you go through chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, chapter 10, chapter 11, chapter 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, last chapter. And in last chapter, it ends on verse 78, which is somewhat of winding up verses. But the critical verse, almost towards the end, is the verse 73. Here we see in chapter 2 beginning, he's asking, help me as your shishya. And your shishya. Okay? And look what Arjuna says. Arjuna uvacha nashto moha smritir labdha tvat prasadan mayachata sitos migata sandehaha karishye vachanam tava. So he's saying, can you turn to the last image? Thank you. This is the end. He is not only seeing his guru, he has seen the darshan of Brahman through his guru. Guru's kripa, guru's grace, guru's compassion. And he says, in this last 73rd verse, in the last chapter, he says, moha nashtaha. Nashtaha, my moha has been, my delusion is gone. Smriti labdha, I have remembered everything. Because we say that you have only forgotten who you are. You are not foolish or stupid or crazy or wrong. We just have to remember. It's all inside you because you are Brahman. So he says, Smriti labdha, I have remembered. I have by your grace. It's not arrogance, by your grace. And I remain now asmi stita, free from all doubts. And then what does he say? He doesn't say, okay, now I think I'm just going to fly around the universe or go on a vacation. And, you know, he says, okay, so now I'll go back to the war. What does it mean? Yeah, I've become a jnani. I know everything. So I guess I'm a butcher. I'll go be a butcher. I'm a soldier. I'll go be a soldier. Right? When Janya gains all the knowledge, then she will say, okay, I have the knowledge and I think I'll go run now the awakening community circle. That's it. Guys, this is like an asleep person was a soldier. Now an awake person is the soldier. And the awake person is not suffering from their own samsara. They are not suffering. And he says, I shall karishye vachanam tava. I shall carry out your duty. O Achyuta, O infallible, unchanging Lord. So, you see that the question this begging student had asked, please help me. I am having such stifling confusion, upahata, in my hidayam, in my thinking and feeling faculties blocked. And by 18th chapter, he said, my moha, my delusions are gone. I have complete clarity. So, you can say that in a way, that between this verse, verse 7 of chapter 2 and verse 73 of chapter 18, there's going to be a transformation. And if you are also keenly feeling it, writing it, connecting with it, thinking about it, because Bhagavad Gita will only come to you once in this lifetime. So if you stay with it fully, then what will happen is you shall also transform. This is the promise. This is the beauty of it. It's a working manual. It is not just a book. And so you can also transform with it. So this is one thing that I wanted to share with you. And do you like that? Can I see some hands? Wonderful. Oh, all my children are raising their hands. Wonderful. Now let us look at who is a shishya. Okay, who is a shishya? And because he said, you know, he has become a shishya. This is what we are understanding. And because he's shishya, so no guru will come and say, I am your guru. People can say, I am your acharya. Acharya is the title. It's just the formal title of somebody who comes and teaches you scriptures. Acharya doesn't mean equal to guru. Acharya doesn't come and say, okay, Shreyas, I'm your guru. Okay, Govind, I'm your guru. It has no meaning. Student has to say, I am your student, be my guru. first of all. So this is the way it happens. And student has to become a shishya. Who is a shishya? So I'm spending a lot of time in the Sanskrit dictionary, this fat dictionary. Next time I'll show you. I have a dictionary and I was doing some work because Baba had given me some understandings, so I wanted to clarify in my own mind. So, you know, all Sanskrit words come from root words. Root words. So one root word can give birth to 5,000 words. And that root word and its meaning will remain in those 5,000 words. So if you know the root words, it becomes a very creative language, you know, to know. So the word Shishya comes, has relationship with two root words. Okay. So the root word is known as Shas. S-H-A-A-S. So Vidya, if you can write in Sanskrit and that word Sha, and then Aki Matra and Hafsa, no? Shas. Okay. This is the Shankh Wala Sha. Shankh. Okay. So Shas. Now the root word Shas is connected with Shishya. It is connected with Shastra. It is connected with Shasana. It is connected with Shastra, many words. And it is specially connected with Shishya in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. And so the word root Shas means, are you ready? To correct, to chastise, to censor, to guide, to control, to rule, to discipline, to govern. These are all the words. Okay. Now, there are a couple of Sanskrit words. Do you know that? Do you know what is Shastra? Scriptures, right? Do Shastras give you commandment? Yes or no? Yes. Do they govern your understanding? Yes. Okay. There is another word called Shasan. Shasana means the governance by law. Does governance give you commandment? Does it correct you? Does it punish you if you are doing wrong thing? Does it censor you? Does it want to take you in a certain direction? Yes. And there is another word called Shastra, not Shastra, which means scripture. Shastra. Shastra means weapon. And weapon also censors you, corrects you. If you are not going to listen to the government or you are not going to follow the scripture, then the weapon may come to you one day. Can happen, doesn't it? So to see all the things, most people go, they get governed by law, which is Shasan, or they get governed by police, which is Shastra, and the spiritual seekers, they like to be governed by what? Shastra, scriptures. Do you see? It is a conscious way of being governed. And from Shastra comes the name for the teacher, Shastri. In India, Acharya is also known as Shastri. Shastri, which means the one who knows Shastra. And Shastri also means the one who censors, the one who corrects. If there is an Acharya who doesn't correct, it's not an Acharya. Acharya corrects, Shastri corrects. Otherwise, student will remain in their samsara, no? Like the job of the editor is to correct. Anytime I write my book and I send it to the editor, it comes back red because that is their job. So the teacher's job is to correct the thinking process, right? So censor doesn't always mean scolding from an ego perspective. We are talking about higher level censor. This is Sanskrit. This is beautiful thing we are looking at. Because even Arjuna, Krishna ji had to censor Arjuna's thinking and then take him to the right place. So this is not feel good spirituality. This is real deal. And so from this root shas comes Shishya. So who is Shishya? Shishya is one who voluntarily, that's the word, voluntarily accepts to be corrected by the guru. Voluntarily. If the you are correcting me too much, I don't like being corrected. You should have corrected me not publicly but privately. Oh, you corrected 5 times, more, 6 times, is it too much? Then it is not shishya. Because the shishya is saying, look, on my own, it didn't work out. So you kindly correct me. Then voluntarily accepts rules. Why? Because discipleship has rules. Some of the rules, for example, that Aparna was sharing for you, you know, sit up, be available, be present. And I didn't hear because I joined late, but we always, Aparna is always teaching these Vinay rules. So these are rules. So the Shishya voluntarily accepts the rules. Some of the rules are, there that are needed so that the student can stay in a position for maximum receptivity of the jnanam. So the student, the Shishya, says that I accept my teacher's will over my will. Then, so therefore, the student, the Shishya, says that if there is even some disciplining, disciplines like speech discipline, food discipline, lifestyle, wake up discipline, mannerism disciplines, such things, meditation disciplines, honesty disciplines, then I shall follow them voluntarily. So, you see, only obedience can lead to discipline. So this is something, modern students get really uncomfortable with the word obedience. Because I'm noticing there are some new age spiritual teachers. One of them is wearing a funny underwear and dancing. I saw on Sounds True website. What is his name? He's the funny spiritual guy. Very scary. So he mocks gurus. And he is the latest guru. I should look him up. I forget his name. So, anyway. So today I saw that he was live and he was wearing underwear. And he was walking around. And he was wearing leopard skin underwear. Because, yogis used to wear leopard skin. So he wore a leopard skin underwear. And he was frolicking about, making joke of gurus. And he's the bestseller spiritual teacher today. Most celebrated author by Sounds True, sadly. So, those kind of gurus will not give you any discipline, okay? And this is the state of the world today. But we are talking about Krishna, talking about Arjuna. We are talking about Baba. We're talking about a tradition here. And over here, therefore, Shishya has a meaning. Shishya means that I agree that I need to be regulated. My thinking needs to be regulated. The way my senses are going here and there, it needs to be regulated. So from time to time, my teacher may chastise me. My teacher might say, where are you going? What are you thinking? How did you take this decision? Now you have regressed. So that is part of the job and this is how I will move forward. So this is, you will now remember, Shastra means weapon. Shastra means scripture. Shasana means governance by king or government. And Shishya means disciple who willingly accepts there is a rule to the discipleship. It is not random. Oh, I think I'll just take a satsang. There you remain a sadasya. But when you become a shishya, you voluntarily say, okay, I'm now going to learn the way my guru shall teach me. There is another root. One was shas and the other is shish. Shish. Okay. She and then pet kitasha. Half. Halant. Shish. So like shishta, shishtachar, shishya. Shish means what is left behind. So what is shishya? After shishya has surrendered their ego, what is left behind is shishya. Isn't that lovely? Okay, my ego doesn't live. What I was yesterday, I am not today. That is Shishya. I like that. You know? So what, because Shish also means residue. And so Shish is the residue of what? When the ego was being purified, what is left behind is Shishya. And Shish also means the one who is taught, directed, commanded, disciplined, cultured, educated, mannered, and taught behavior. You know, you people are all engineers, doctors, professors, lawyers, and you are like, what is she saying? Mannered, taught, educated, behavior. What is all this? Well, you can understand that this is a different vocabulary. This is a different type of understanding. This is not anything to do with the world. So, you know, for example, I may know anything in the world, but I had to learn from my grandfather how not to be violent in my speech, you know, or how not to be, how not to inflict harm, you know, but at the same time, be who I am, be an acharya, be a teacher, do my job. So these are new types of learnings that we have to undergo. And for that, we have to surrender something. And whatever is left behind, that residue gets instructed. So that is called Shish. So therefore, he became a Shishya when he said that, the Sanskrit is Shishyasteham Shadhimam Tva Prapannam, I surrender to you. Now, something I want to point out that this Shadi Mam is an important word. It means teach me. Now, I really need to point this out to you. All this time, it's not like Arjuna had met Krishna for the first time. Krishna and Arjuna as human beings in a contemporary time were related. They were related by blood. They were related by a just cause, by dharma. And everybody looked up to Lord Krishna. So he was an advisor, not only to Arjuna, to his brothers, to his mother, to the whole family. He was a very key figure in the whole Mahabharata. And we see many episodes prior to the Bhagavad Gita where Arjuna goes to Lord Krishna with a problem. Lord Krishna advises him. Arjuna overcomes that problem with that advice. That's it. So he changed his relationship from Krishna being his advisor to being his teacher. There's a difference. If we keep going to our teacher for advice, I hit a problem in my life, I need your advice, then the teacher is merely giving a band-aid. And that's okay. We can reach out to our teacher for that. But if we remain in that relationship, then it is like the teacher is giving the student a fish to eat rather than teach them how to do fishing. So a genuine Shishya is not wanting a relationship only of, can you fix my current problem? My advice, which is fine to go in an emergency or whatever, because even Arjuna did that. But ultimately, the relationship between Guru Shishya is in a genuine relationship. Nowadays, there is some understanding that some other understandings of Guru Shishya, but in the traditional understanding, the Shishya will awaken also to their inner Guru. And for that, what is important is that knowledge. What makes the guru have all the answers and the student doesn't have the answer? The student remains clouded. So the teacher says, instead of seeking my advice, should I marry this person? Should I fire that person? Should I hire that person? Should I buy that house? Should I sell that house? Should I X, Y, Z? So many things are there, which the teacher may give you a more rounded out idea, but it is you are subverting the relationship to remain at a advisor client level. Do you understand what I'm saying? When you want to go beyond into a guru shishya relationship, then you quietly listen and you hope to receive systematic teachings from that guru, that the guru is kind upon you and they don't make an appointment that I shall teach you a class and don't show up. They are showing, they are committed, you show up and you keep listening. And actually what will happen is your hidayam will become clear and answers shall shine within you. So the true teacher gives knowledge. And that is when the guru-shishya relationship happens, where guru has the opportunity to give some knowledge, understanding that the student may have few emergency issues, which probably the guru can help. But in the long run, the student knows that the answer is in this knowledge. So this word Shadi Mam is very important. And this is the changing of the relationship from Krishna, the occasional advisor, life strategy advisor, to turning into a teacher of the awakening wisdom, the awakening of who Arjuna really is, so that he can say, Smriti Labdha, I remembered. Because after once Arjuna remembered, he went through some difficult tragedies in his life, but we don't have Arjuna going back to Krishna saying, sorry, oops, I'm back to square one. There is actually a permanent transformation that happens as a result of this exchange. So this is another signifier of the Shishya, that the Shishya is not just seeking solace for life, but is seeking the knowledge of the self. This is the difference. That's what I wanted to come to, that he wanted the knowledge and he asked specifically for the knowledge, because we have countless conversations in the Mahabharata where he says, Hey Krishna, Duryodhana said this and Bhishma said this and Drona said this. What do you think I should do? Those are like strategic conversations. So much for the strategic conversations. That didn't really stop Arjuna from having a breakdown, did it? He just got his, because he was outsourcing his knowledge and his understanding to Krishna and then flowing it in his life and, you know, not really learning anything. And then he stood steadfast. He didn't leave. He didn't even take a bathroom break, nothing. He's listening. He's there. And he's asking the kind of questions that a thinking student will ask. And then gradually, it is really due to Arjuna's questions that we really get to get the essence of Lord Krishna's teaching. So he was asking such intelligent questions that the whole knowledge got transferred into Arjuna, and the knowledge itself revealed to Arjuna. He had become complete. He had become complete. Even in my own example, the students who have maximum ability to take my advice on a frequent basis may have to be very vigilant in case that is the only relationship they have. And sometimes I have noticed that those students are not transforming as much as a quiet student who I have never talked to, who is listening. Who may think, oh, I don't think I can ask for a quick advice, so I will use knowledge. You see the difference? One is an outside fix, one is an internal knowledge. So I wanted to tell you that when I tell you, okay, no more, I will not give you advice. What it really means is I love you. And I want you to turn into Arjuna, because I know that you are capable of coming from that same clarity. I want you to deeply grow into what is your inheritance, which is jnanam, which is shakti, which is power, which is clarity. and not simply, at every pothole, at every difficulty, seek one hand, because then you remain dependent. So advice makes you dependent. Knowledge makes you independent. That's the summary of everything. And we do see exactly, you know, Krishna as an Acharya is actually really showing Acharya Dharma. So he barely spoke few words. He didn't jump in. He didn't try to sort out the panic attack. I mean, after all, they had such a relationship. They knew each other. He had seen Arjuna grow up. He should have been hugging him and holding him. And he stood there quietly while Arjuna had his whole emotional, episode rather, And then when Arjuna got ready to say, maybe there is another option. So it was an open-mindedness. Then and said, will you teach me? Is then when Arjuna started teaching. And we have a receptive Krishna through all the way until the last verse. And we have a very generous teacher in the form of Bhagwan, Lord Krishna, all the way. And at the end, Sanjaya, who's reporting this, says that I have become blessed to overhear this conversation. And as long as they are teachers like Krishna and they are students like Arjuna, then we will all come through, that this is what it is. So we are about to enter from December onwards, verse by verse study. And I am going to ask you, Aparna, if you could send a poll out to the anchor students to see if they would like to meet me twice a month now. Otherwise, I don't really see how I'll ever go through the Bhagavad Gita, because now there is no story to tell, and often a shloka may take 20 minutes, 25 minutes, 1 hour. So we're going to get really slowed down, because as the shlokas are about life and atma and afterlife, it's going to take time. So one, I wanted to know that if there is interest, once again, if the students are interested, what's the point of me showing up and Aparna showing up? If more of you are showing up, then I can show up on the fourth, Thursday, right? Fourth Thursday also. Second and fourth to continue our shloka by shloka study. And then in some months we have a fifth Thursday. And I was thinking that to make this study engaged, it's very important to have an engaged study. Otherwise, we will, because there is Jnana Yoga, there's Karma Yoga, and then there is Bhakti Yoga. So we will Upasana Yoga. So it will just be a lot of knowledge. It's important to process it together. And that's what a Sampradaya does. We process it. So I was thinking that in the few months of the year where we have five Thursdays, maybe I can give you an assignment. And just like we had today, and I can request some of you people to organize among yourself with help of Aparna and some of the senior shishyas like Vimla. And you could share, read out to each other, discuss. I could put in a question, because then the knowledge comes alive. For example, if Lord Krishna is saying that if he's saying that those you are killing are dead already, what does that mean? That's a very significant piece thing to say. So it's like I could give you one shloka, two lines, and five Thursdays are not always there. So pretty much all Thursdays you are studying satsang. This is extra work for the AV team, Soham. But I want you to talk amongst yourself as an anchor group and come back. And Aparna will then come back to me to let me know what is the vote, what is the interest. And if, say, one day Soham is not there, is there backup for hosting this meeting, etc.? And then we can have a little more strength into our Bhagavad Gita study. We don't want to lose momentum in the important chapters that are coming up. So that is what I would say to you.